Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Hello, it's my pleasure to introduce Shlomo Shamai, my good friend from Israel. Who's going to talk about graphical models and statistical mechanics and communication and storage applications. Noam has an undergraduate degree in physics and a PhD in computational neuroscience from the Hebrew University, and he's recently joined the CS department of the Open University in Israel.
Okay. I'd like to thank Thomas for inviting me. So I'll start by the... By telling you about the applications, and then we'll see the graphical models and the statistical mechanics part. So the first application I'm going to talk about is storage, namely hard disks. The technology has come a long way since this 1956 hard disk, which was 5 megabytes, until today is 1 terabyte hard disk. You can see that the areal density in these hard disks was 2 kilobits per square inch, while in the new hard disk it's about 150 gigabits per square inch. But basically, the technology goes like this. I mean, if you want to store, the data is stored in concentric tracks. And there's a head that approaches the track, and it has a reading sensor and a writing sensor. And it approaches the track, and it reads the bits that's stored here. And from our perspective, what's important is the fact that the bits are stored in one dimension. Okay. And now the question is, how can you increase the areal density? And what people have come up with is to go up from one dimension to two dimensions. So it goes like this. I mean, there's a grid. Every grid point holds one bit. Okay, and so. In principle, people have calculated that it's possible to increase areal density to 1 terabits per square inch. Okay, so it's quite an advantage, and it's not a science fiction. This example has 6 tera per square inch, and this is an IBM example which has 1 tera per square inch. So people have demonstrated the fact that it can be done. More than that, yes. And there are other mechanisms, I mean, technologies which can increase that even further. All of them are stored the bits in two dimensions. Okay, so it's a new technology, it has new problems. And the problem goes like this. When a head, the reading head, approaches the disk, let's say you want to read this bit. So the head approaches the bit, okay, then it reads it. But what you actually read is the information from this bit together with interference from neighboring bits. Okay? So at the end, the received data is a combination of what you read from here and the neighborhood of the bit. So in a sense, you can think about this as a communication channel, a communication problem. There's a source, the data that you want to restore, for example, the hard disk, the bits that are stored in the hard disk. It goes through a channel, I mean, a noisy channel, which is the head in this case, and you this is the observable. This is the data that you actually read. So this communication problem has two important problems that you have to solve. The first one is to restore the bits. You have to know what exactly is stored in the hard disk. And the second question is to estimate the capacity. You want to know how much information you can store in such a hard disk so it can be retrieved without mistakes. Another example is a second application, which is really communications application, is an indoor wireless LAN. Each red point here is a hotspot, and you can see they have some two-dimensional topology. Let's say you want to read what a certain hotspot says. Okay, so this is the analog of this reading head. So you want to read this one, this hotspot, but you get interference from neighboring rooms, for example. Okay, so this is, in a sense, the same application. I mean, the same type of problems. So just some technical jargon. These type of communication channels are called two-dimensional channels. The first example of the hard disk is termed inter-symbol interference channels, ISI. Okay, this is the hard disk. While the indoor wireless LAN problem is one example of a multiple access channel. Okay, now during the talk, I will give example of this of the hard disk because just for clarity, I mean, the paper we wrote is contains results for both of these channels, but I will talk only about the first one. So the paper is actually an interdisciplinary work, which, I mean, the problem stems from electrical engineering, and the methods that we use originate from physics and from graphical models. And all these people, I mean, come from different disciplines, and it's kind of nice to have them all work together. Okay, so in case I don't survive this talk, this is what I want you to, these are the things I want you to remember. So we asked two questions. The first one is the question of detection. How do you restore the information in the hard disk? And the second one is information rate, which you can grossly think of right now as a problem of capacity. What is the capacity of such a hard disk? We do it. We analyze the properties of these channels based off graphical models and statistical mechanics. The results that we get are practically optimal. I mean, as if we do it exactly, and we do it in a computational efficient way, which allows for distributed computation. Okay. So, and just one example of our results. We take here a hard disk, and we want to calculate its capacity. Okay, we calculate the capacity as a function of the noise. Okay, this is high noise. This is low noise, and this is high noise. Let's say when the noise is very low, for each bit that you store, you can you need one bit of information in order to restore the bit that you store. Okay, but if the noise is high, let's say you need 5 bits of information just to retrieve 1 bit that is stored in the hard disk. And until our work, until 2003, only an upper bound and a lower bound of this information rate were known. They were calculated by Chen and Siegel, and these are the dash dotted lines over here. And you can see our results, which are the squares here, and you see that they fall just within these bounds. Okay, so this was kind of nice. When we got this, we know that we have something nice in our hands. Okay, outline. So first I'll describe the channel model. Then we'll see what is it we need to measure in order to perform detection. I remind you, detection is understanding what are the bits that are stored inside in the hard disk, and measure the information rate, the quote-unquote capacity of the hard disk. We'll see that we have to map it to a graphical model, and then we see how we actually solve the problem of detection and information rate. Well, information rate we'll do in two different routes. The first route is done by a theorem from electrical engineering, a recent theorem. And the second is done via statistical mechanics and information theory. And the last question that we're going to ask is, how come this problem is solved so well? Because generally, these kinds of problems are not really, I mean, the performance is not really good. And the question is, what are the intrinsic properties of this system that allows for just such good performance? Okay, the model is quite simple. You have this n by n grid, and the bits that we stored are marked by x at the position kl. These are binary bits, binary symbols. But we don't have access to these bits. We have access to the to YKL, which are the observed our observables, which equals X plus some binary Gaussian noise, and some local interference. It goes like this. I mean, you want to read this bit, but you get interference from some neighborhood around it. I mean, each of these bits contribute its value, okay, times some linear constant, some linear value, which can be constant or not. It depends on the channel. Okay, so you read this, and you get contribution from a certain neighborhood around it. Okay, so and each such channel, each such application, has its own neighborhood and interference properties. For example, the hard disk, the ISI, inter-symbol interference channel, has this type of interference. This is not a graph, a directed graph. This is the way the interference works. I mean, this bit interferes this one. It's being interfered by this one, this one, and this one. That's the in this case, it is. There are cases in which it's symmetrical. Okay. Okay. So and this can be written in a vector matrix form. Y, which is a vector of length n squared, equals the noise plus the data that is stored times S, which is the n squared by n squared interference matrix, which holds all these interference values. And each such channel is characterized by a different such matrix. Okay, and these are two examples of such channels. So we know that our channel is Y equals SX plus V. And let's see how do we perform, what do we need to do in order to perform detection and calculate the information rate. So detection is restoring the information. We have to calculate the marginal posterior probability. What is the probability of xi being equal 1 or minus 1 given our observables? And we take the maximal probability. This is our detected value. But in order to do that, we have to marginalize over the joint posterior probability. Okay. Well, I'm not showing this, but in order to calculate the symmetric information rate, this is the value, the property that the statistics that we are trying to evaluate. We either need the joint posterior probability or the marginal posterior probability. We'll see why in a minute. And in both cases, the number of such terms in the summation is exponential, and so direct calculation is not possible. So in order to calculate these values, we map the problem into a graphical model. Let's see how it goes. We have to infer the posterior probability. So we using Bayes rules, we can write it this way. But now P of Y is a constant, okay? And given X, the probability of Y, let's say if X is given, the probability of Y is simply the distribution of V, which is Gaussian. So the posterior probability is proportional to P of X and this Gaussian term. But now if we assume that X are IID and equipoble IID in binary, and we can simplify this term, and we get this formula. We have two terms. The first term is quadratic, okay, with a Rij, which is an entry in a matrix R, which is simply S transpose X. Okay, this is so R holds the interference problems or properties of the problem, and the linear term, where the prefactor Hi is Y transpose S. You see it holds both the observables and the interference. And when a physicist looks at this, at these terms, it sees a randomizing model with inhomogeneous Ising model with random fields. And when a graphical models person looks at it, it just sees an MRF and an undirected graphical model. Okay, so and so what we do is just assign, we have two types of potential. We have a pairwise potential and a local field. These are the two, and these are their values. And now let's look at an example. I mean, if we take, you take an interference matrix S, you plug it into this into the formula, and you get this graphical model. The full dots are the hidden variables. You get an edge between every bit, every two bits that interact or interfere with each other, and you have a local field which is marked by these hollow hollow circles. But now, the question is, what have we gained by that? I mean, it's just nomenclature. We didn't really solve the problem, but what we did do is just opened the, allowed ourselves to use the inference toolbox that all the inference methods in graphical models. And this is why this mapping is important. We can now use whatever graphical models people tell us to do in order to calculate these posterior probabilities. Okay, so in order to do inference, the first shot at inference is do exact inference, but in this case, exact inference using a junction tree algorithm just reduces the naive complexity from this value to this exponential value, which is useless. Okay. And then you have to do approximate inference. You can either use belief propagation, and we see why belief propagation doesn't work in this case, and then we resort to generalized belief propagation, which we just did the job. Okay. I'll just briefly describe why belief propagation doesn't really work in this case. I mean, I assume everybody knows belief propagation. I mean, it's all very loose, and you know, I just want you to get the feel of the thing. So, BP is exact on a tree, but people use it when the graph is not a tree. And it has very nice examples in which it works for when the graph has loops, for example, low density parity check codes. But the BP works when the effective length of your cycles is rather long. So the graph is in practice a tree. Okay, but in our case, the complete opposite. We have many short loops, so BP doesn't really converge, never in our examples. So we have to resort to generalized belief propagation, which is simply you can think of it as if BP sends the messages between nodes, generalized belief propagation defines regions. Okay, and these regions are metanodes, and you just convey your messages between these metanodes. So you define. No, on this type of MRF, it does not converge.
It's very similar to the standard MRF. You just have a small local neighborhood. So
yes,
that's true, but...
Okay, it does not converge because of the value of the potentials. Okay? I mean, if you look at the graph, it could have been, you know, anything. But the specific potentials you plug in make it not to converge, cause it not to forget.
Excuse me? So special about this potential, what's the intuition behind this?
The intuition behind what? The potentials?
Potentials are making things difficult. How would you explain why they're not working out? Because the interference problem you talked about, I would assume that neighbors influence things slightly. And that's the exact situation where BP would work well. If there's lots of conflicts among these local potentials, then I would see how maybe BP would have a problem.
And this is yeah, exactly
so
what happens.
Us, yeah.
These values are rather large. Okay, they are not negligible compared to this one, to these values. Okay, and the noise can be rather large. So it happens that the potential are I mean, the graph is, the cycles really matter, Okay, when you look at the potential, it's not that they are if you look at pairs, they are almost decoupled. They are not. They are highly correlated, and there's in some situations there's frustration, and it's really it is a hard job to.
But it's neighborhood coupling with the idea that neighboring values are kind of similar, mm-hmm. often, right? In those kind of cases, like smoothness constraints are usually easily found by BP. Are your alphas here more variable or something?
The alpha can it be in itself? They are either constants in one application, and they are in the other application they are random variables.
Large variability. Zero, one, but alphas are -5 or -7.
No, the alpha also goes. The standard deviation of these alphas can be at the order of one, something like this.
So it's order one.
Yeah, really yeah. It is a difficult problem.
They're really sort of pseudo random, so that you have one neighbor sending a message which is very low, the other one which is very high.
It's kind of confusing. Excuse me?
What is the application we get these random alphas?
This is the multiple access application. It's called the Wiener model. All of these problems are, we didn't invent the problem. We took the exact parametrization from the engineers. Okay, they have a real problem to solving that, and we just map this problem to something we know how to deal with, and it happens that it deals with it well. That's the whole idea. Okay, so generalized belief propagation, as I said, is just, you can think about it as moving from one node to a region. Each region is a metanode, and then you send messages between these nodes. And the idea is that that the effective length of the cycles that you get becomes larger, because most of the small or short loops are intrinsic to these regions, which you do exactly. Okay, so effectively, the length of the cycles that you get becomes larger, which resorts back to these problems in which BP works well. Okay, and let's see how we do it. So we define a 3x3 region like this, and you just slide it by one to the right and below. So this is one region, another region, a third one, and a fourth one, and BP gives us a way to send messages between these regions. And there's a whole lot of nomenclature that takes care of the fact that you don't count or overcount, and you do it in a sound way. Okay, so in order to calculate the posterior probabilities, what I've shown you is that you have to do inference using generalized belief propagation. So how do you do detection? Detection is really trivial. You run GBP, generalized belief propagation, until it converges, and then you read off the marginal probabilities. You take if xi equals 1 has a larger probability than xy equals minus 1, you just decide that it's plus 1. Okay? Let's look at examples. So here we calculate the bit error rate, okay, the quality of the detection as a function of the noise. We take a small system, which we can calculate exactly using the junction tree. This system has this alpha, these interference values of 1/2, and these are the values that you get exactly. These are the errors that are the optimal errors that you can get at this type of noise. And these are our results. They look very similar. And another example. Now alpha in this case is higher. But in this case, I show you the bit error rate. I don't say anything about the quality or the quality of inferring the marginal probabilities. Okay. I have to show you that whether the marginal probabilities are approximated within a certain margin or not. And this is the, excuse me?
BP
doesn't converge, so it has no, I mean, okay, I mean, after a constant number of, well, we didn't do that. I mean, it just, I mean, once it doesn't converge, I mean, you don't really know when to stop. I mean, it's an endless loop. It's not really, I don't think that stopping at a certain, I mean, there's no use in stopping at that one. I mean, if you stop at, let's say, 10,000 cycles, and it will give you completely different results as a million cycles. So it's, I mean, what would you choose?
No, that it would give you a completely
different answer.
You can choose, you can stop it when you get, I mean, so whatever, you pick one and you just show what one stoppage, you know, criterion.
Okay.
Or you can do a sort of separate training to see when to stop or something like that.
Okay, we didn't do that. I mean, we just gave up. We saw that, we started with beep. I mean, we wanted to do the straightforward thing. And it didn't work. Actually, we were not the first to observe the fact that BP doesn't work. What people did before us.
I believe that. How badly does it fail?
Okay. I mean, I don't have the results here. Okay. But now I would like to show you that the marginal probabilities are evaluated in a very accurately. So this is the absolute value between the exact marginal probabilities and the GBP marginal probabilities as a function of the noise. Okay. So you see, and this is averaged over a 9 by 9 systems. So it's a rather large sample. So for example, if the exact marginal probabilities is 0.25. This is the margin that you get with GBP, which is rather good. It's not just that the detection is good. The marginal probabilities are almost correct. I mean, exact. Okay. So this was detection, and now let's see what happens in the case of information noise. So I'll first remind you what mutual information is. You want to know what is how much information does one variable convey about the other. You can write it as the entropy of one variable y in this case minus the entropy of y given x, and these are small y's because this is a differential entropy. And when you want and the mutual information, information rate, you're just simply looking at the limit of this value per symbol. At the limit of very large systems. So if we use this formula, we get these two limits. And actually, in our case, we measure the symmetric information rate, which simply means that we assume that the data that we store in the hard disk is IID and equiprobable, plus and minus one with the same probability, which is a rather sound hypothesis. In your hard disk, I mean, half of the bits are up and the other are down. I mean, it's okay, and it's not something unique. Okay, so and we'll do that in two different routes. The first route will be to go through the Guo-Shamai-Verdu theorem from information theory, from electrical engineering. This is a rather new theorem, and we'll see that in order to calculate the information rate in this case, we only need the marginal probabilities. And the second route would be to go through statistical mechanics, and this will have to deal with the Shannon-McMillan-Breiman theorem, and in this case, we have to calculate the joint posterior probability. Okay, so and I'll first describe the Guo-Shamai-Verdu theorem in our perspective. This is a rather recent result, and it goes like this. I mean, using GBP, we can calculate the marginal posterior probability, the probability that x equals 1 and the probability that xi equals minus 1. So we can calculate the average, xi hat. This is the average value. Now, and this is, of course, a function of our observables and the noise. But now, since we have the correct information that is stored, we can calculate the MMSE, the minimum mean square error of this system. Okay, and what Guo-Shamai and Verdu have shown that is that the mutual information, the derivative of the mutual information with respect to the noise is simply a constant times this MMSE error. Okay, this is a new result. It's quite impressive because it creates some connection between information theory and what they call detection theory. Okay, this is a rather brilliant result. Okay, so what do we have to do in order to calculate the information rate? So it's rather simple. We have to calculate the marginal probabilities, okay? Then plug it, use them to calculate x hat and the MMSE, and then just simply integrate the values that you get over the different noise levels, and divide by n squared, and then we get the information rate. That's the prescription. Okay. The second route I'll talk about is the statistical mechanics way. So I remind you, these two terms of the information rate. But if you look at this term, the entropy of y given x, okay, if x is given, the entropy of y is simply the entropy of V, which is Gaussian, which has a closed form formula. So we don't. This term is just a constant. And in order to calculate the information rate, the only thing we have to do is calculate this limit. And here, and in order to do that, we use the Shannon-McMillan-Breiman theorem, which tells us that in order that we can replace the entropy of y by log of p of y in the limit, or minus log of p of y in the limit. Okay. So calculating the information, the only thing we have to do is calculate the information rate is calculate P of Y in the limit of very large systems. And let's see how we do it. It's very easy to write down the prior probability of P of Y, and you see that it has two terms, a constant and an exponential minus n squared f, where f is known as the free energy per symbol. It's a statistical mechanics notion of free energy. It's simply the log of the sum of an exponential number of states. So there's a problem. We need to calculate f in the limit of very large systems, but we cannot calculate f even for very small systems because the number of terms is exponential. Okay, so. Okay, so what do? We approximate it. We approximate it using a method from 1950, which is called cluster variation method or the Kikuchi method. Okay, so we replace this f for very large for infinite n by fcvm, the free energy, the approximated free energy for a finite n. And the question: how is it done? And the answer is GBP, because Yedidia, Freeman, and Weiss have shown that that stationary points of this FCVM are simply the points to which GBP converges to. So the prescription is very simple. You take a large but finite system, you apply GBP, which gives you the free energy, and you just plug it into the formula. And let's see, now the question is, how good is this free energy approximation? So we take a system, let's say a system of size 9. It's a 9x9 system. We calculate the free energy, its free energy exactly, and you compare it to the free energy that we get by the approximation. And this is the root mean square error in percent. So you can see it's rather small. So our free energy approximation is okay. So the question is, the second question is, how large should n be in order to be to approximate what happens in the limit of large n? And we can see here the free energy of many systems as a function of the system size. And we see that we have chosen to use n equals 30. You can see the variation between different systems is rather small. Okay, But in principle, we could have used any other n. I mean, this we can apply this method at any other, at even larger n. It's no problem. So, but we have chosen to work with n equal 30. And using this n, value of n, we get this information rate as a function of the noise that I showed you at the beginning. And these are the bounds that Siegel and Chen and Siegel have come up with, and the squares are our values. Okay. So we saw that detection is practically exact. Information rate falls within the bounds. And now the question, the last question I would like to address is how come this problem really, I mean, we can supply such good results, okay? And the truth is that we don't have any rigorous answer for that, only indirect evidence. And I'll describe two of them. The first question is, should we use really GBP or do we have to, can we use other methods? And in order to do that, we ask ourselves, what is the important property of GBP that really does the job? And we've come up with the fact that the regions are overlapping. If you take this out, if you take regions which are not overlapping, the results that you get are inferior. So the important property of GBP that really makes it work in this case is the fact that the regions are overlapping. And now the question is, how can we get such a near optimal performance? And in order to understand that, we calculated what the correlation length, which is a statistical mechanics term, which actually tells you what is the distance in the system, okay, by which two symbols or spins are not correlated anymore, or not influenced by one another. Because what we have here in all these graphical model stuff is calculation is not global, is not done in the whole system. It's done in local regions. If local regions can solve the whole job, okay, then propagating the information will work. But if you need to know the value of a symbol which is way far away, which is far away from you, no graphical model will ever solve this problem. So we calculated the correlation length. And we saw that it's in the order of the regions that we get. So in this, the fact that we perform well is due to the properties of the system. The system has a short correlation length. I mean, you don't really know, don't have to know the value of a bit which is at the other side of the hard disk in order to infer the value that you have over here. But you really need to know what happens. In some neighborhood around you, which is rather large, and therefore you really need to do message passing.
So basically, the difference between this and say any kind of an MRF over an image or anything that's smooth, mm-hmm. is that it's really not smooth. It's local, but it's not smooth. Is that the difference?
I think there are two differences. First of all, the first difference is the fact that the pairwise potential are completely different than we know in vision. But the second one is the external fields.
Different which way? In their variance? Or
yeah. Yes. The second one is the fact that we have external fields. These are like, you can think about this as constraints over the problem. The external fields somehow constrain the problem and make it more local. Okay? This is why, this is another. This is something that does not happen in vision. Okay.
How do you define correlation
length? In physics, I hope I have it. You calculate the transfer matrix, and then the two. It's the ratio between the first two largest eigenvalues, or the log. Let's see if I have it here. Somewhere. No, I don't think I have it. I'm sorry.
So it's really really a measure of how far an influence stretches. It's not an absolute cutoff.
No, it's an average. It just gives you a feel of how, how local is the system. Okay, because at a phase transition, for example, this value diverges. Okay, so you cannot take, let's say, you cannot take a standard MRF, lower the temperature, and think that it will work. It will not work, because at some point this value diverges, and then no local calculation will ever work. Okay, I'll just summarize. Okay, so we've applied GVP for 2D channels. The method I've presented you, I haven't shown it, but believe me, is way superior to other contemporary methods. It's a kind of nice combination of information theory, statistical mechanics, and graphical models, but we are kind of... We're not really pleased by the fact that we don't really understand rigorously why it works. I mean, this is something that may be interesting to do.
One of the only known problems where GVP really has been shown to be
it's much better than any other
approximation.
You know, we have our joint work in which we did segmentation using GVP. It's a different MRF. It works well over there, but I think this is the only real problem on. This is a real problem in which GVP is really needed. I mean, a real-world problem in which you really need GVP in order to work. I mean,
BP is not going to work.
No, BP does not work. What people have done is all these variants of BP. You just apply BP to the rows of the system and then to the columns and all these kind of heuristics. And this gives you, a clean a methodology to solve the problems.
Now that we're talking about rows and columns, we've done some work on variational approximations that do row-column breakups. Uh-huh. Or phylogenetic trees, HMM phylogenetic trees, where you also have connections in different directions.
Uh-huh.
How well that would work. But in this case, you probably need to show how poorly BP does. You need to have a number.
Yeah, so we do in the paper. We have in the paper. We can look it up in the paper afterwards.
The most interesting thing that you are hinting at as your future work is the previous slide. I mean, it seems like you're onto something. You know how to analyze it. It seems like correlation length is going to define when BP works, but not just the correlation length. You also want to define when BP doesn't work and GVP works. So short correlation lengths are going to be fine for BP in some cases too, right?
Yeah,
so you
I believe
correlation
it's
length, but then BP doesn't work. So you need those two sort of criteria to define.
I agree.
The regime.
I agree.
And you might be able to derive something theoretically.
You calculating the correlation length is hard. I mean, it's not something that you can do easily for a random, for random systems like this. But but I guess the notion of correlation length is something that people have that people should take into consideration when asking how come our approximation work or does not work. I mean, it's an important notion that people have to. Yeah, it's well defined. As I said, I mean, for simple systems, it's simply the value of the ratio between the eigenvalues.
To redefine it so that your theory is easier. Right? You might need to redefine the notion if it's difficult to deal with that notion of correlation length. You might need to redefine it as something that you can define in some other way that captures this essence, and then you can deal with that measure.
Maybe this is something we should. Okay, I would just like to thank my collaborator first, my brother Ori, who was at the time at UCSD, Shlomo Shamai from the Technion, Ido Kanter from physics in Bar-Ilan, Israel, Tony Weiss from electrical engineering in Tel Aviv University, and Yair Weiss from the Hebrew University.
They're related?
No, they're not related. That's it.
Actually, in these problems you've looked at, are there any problems where there is more room for improvement? Because it seems like GVP
solved
it completely,
yeah,
right?
Completely.
You would
yeah.
say, yeah.
yeah.
So are there problems where there's still room for improvement?
I believe that in these type of problems, no. This is the optimal, practically optimal results. But now you can ask, how come doesn't, I don't know, the hardest industry come in and apply this? Because you don't need it. I mean, the performance, the detection performance in hardest is good in the technology that the algorithm that they already use. You can, I mean, it's more like it's an algorithmic game at the end of the day. It's not something that
kinds of problems. For instance, we know we still can't solve set and set problems, right?
Mm-hmm.
So but that's sort of an extreme. Is there something closer to, because end set problems are not necessarily all that they're useful in the extreme.
Mm-hmm.
But there may be some
intermediate
practical points. Problems. Uh-huh. Any practical problems are nowhere near that complexity, uh-huh. and yet they're not solved. But you know, what are the problems that have these MRF like BP like feel?
Mm-hmm.
But are not quite over there, and are not quite solved yet.
I don't know. I don't have any example of that. I mean,
the thing about this is that it came from an application version. So they had an application in mind, and then you're asking, can you actually come up with a? You want to look like a cross application, right? Find an application.
Well, if they're working on application.
Sure.
No, we haven't yet. No, I mean this is
a
no. It was published in IEEE information theory.